text for this sermon, which is the reading you heard in different languages. Acts 7, 55 and 56, "But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, looked up to heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Look," he said, "I see heaven open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God." Let us pray. Lord of the church, Lord of this church, by your Holy Spirit, open heaven for us. In your great name we pray. Amen. Well, first of all, on behalf of all your brothers and sisters in Christ across the Minnesota South District of the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, I bring greetings from them and also assure you that if they heard about this celebration, they're praying with you today, giving thanks for 125 years of God's grace in this place. The oldest person I've ever met was 112, but this is the first time I'm looking at 125. You actually don't look like you're 125 years old, but it's a wonderful milestone for a church to celebrate, and I'm sure some of you are back from who knows where to just spend a little time in worship at a church that you dearly love. We're all celebrating with you today, not only in our district, but again across the synod. As you know, and as we heard in the children's sermon, 125 years ago, the founders of this church decided to call it St.Stephanus. As far as I can tell, that's the Latin form of Stephen. And that name was chosen because of the greatness of this saint in the life of the early church. Acts 6 and 7 tell his story. He's described as one of the seven, remember, that helped with the food distribution in the early church. He's described as being a very wise person and empowered by the Holy Spirit even to do miracles. And so naturally a following developed with him. There's a group within leadership of Judaism at that time that took him on and ultimately bring him before the Sanhedrin, the high court of Israel, the same court that tried Jesus. And if you want to open your Bibles later, you can look at a wonderful review of the Old Testament that verifies the record of the Old Testament, but then also adds other details that are very helpful for us to know. He goes through the whole history of the Old Testament, and he closes that history by saying, "And you folks, you people, this court murdered the Messiah." And at that point, they begin to turn on him with anger, and at that same point is when our text gives us this beautiful picture depicted on the entrance to the church in the fresco of Stephen looking into heaven and seeing Jesus standing at the right hand of his Father and seeing the glory of God. And then it's at that point that he's dragged outside the city gates and is stoned to death. And his dying words, you remember, are, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit, and Lord, don't hold this sin against them." Sound familiar? Reflected Jesus in the way that he died. So it's a good question, I guess, to ask, and maybe the answer is obvious to you, but I did wonder at first when I talked with the committee representatives, why this particular text? You have the whole Bible to choose from for 125th anniversary, and you chose this text. And the more I worked with it, preparing for today, the more I have to congratulate the committee for a great choice on a text for this anniversary. Because when you have this image of Stephen looking into heaven and seeing Jesus standing there at the right hand of the Father in all of his glory, that says an awful lot about the past of this church, its present, and its future. For one thing, it tells us that just as heaven was open for Stephen, heaven has been opened for 125 years by this church, by your string of pastors, again and again, so that people have been given a glimpse of heaven. And there they've seen Jesus. Their faith has led them to see Jesus as the risen Lord Jesus Christ. What Stephen saw with his own eyes, we see by faith. People here have seen by faith again and again. An old hymn of the church that goes back at least to the 4th century is called the Te Deum Laudamus. Is that the Te Deum, a hymn that you remember? Those of you who used to sing page 32 in the old Lutheran hymnal. Remember that? You sing the Te Deum Laudamus. We praise you, O God. But there's a line in that old hymn that goes, when thou hast overcome the sharpness of death, thou didst open the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Thou sittest at the right hand of God in the glory of the Father. Our faith has always been about heaven, about getting there, about bringing as many people with us as we can so that they land in heaven with us. It's always been about heaven. You've moved with changes in your community as a church. You've committed yourself to educating the young, to reaching immigrants from many different nations. All of that is a part of this story because you understand not everybody's going to make it into heaven. No matter what the culture's telling us, that everybody finally gets into heaven, as long as they're sincere with what they believe. You know that Jesus said, no one comes to the Father but by me. You know that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, that he opens heaven for us. He has done that through his cross and resurrection. So this place has always been about seeing heaven open. Then the second reason that I think this is such a great text is that when we talk about heaven out there in the future, it's not that it's just our destination. It's that because we're going to heaven, we live a particular kind of life. We try to reflect the life of Christ. C.S. Lewis in his Mere Christianity has this great, great statement. If you read history, you'll find that the Christians who did the most for the present world are just those who thought the most of the next. Aim at heaven, and you'll get earth thrown in. Aim at earth, and you'll get neither. In other words, those who thought the most of heaven in history, he goes on to list all the great things that Christians have done through the ages because of heaven being out there, because that's where they were going. In other words, we place heaven before us because heaven, in a real sense, opens earth for us. We see heaven as a place of incredible love, and we want to love. We see people of every tribe and nation, you know this here, so we want to welcome people of every tribe and nation. We see a place of beauty, so we want our worship to be beautiful. We see people serving in heaven, and we want to serve. We see people free of sickness and pain. We want to alleviate sickness and pain and comfort those who are in pain. Christians don't just see a new heaven and new earth in the future. We work toward that new heaven and new earth in the time we have here on earth. Heaven is not just a destination. It's a motivation for the way we are here on earth. When I was a boy, whenever we went to Aunt Florence's house, I remember, we had to get dressed up. And I didn't mind going to Aunt Florence's house, but I didn't like to get dressed up. I can remember actually having to wear a clip-on tie because we were going to Aunt Florence's house. Really, at the age of 7 or 8, I have to wear a clip-on tie. I have to wash and get clean. Why? Because of the destination. Because Aunt Florence was a special aunt, and she deserved to have her nephew looking good. Well, it's the same with us in terms of heaven. Because we're going to heaven, we need to look good here on earth. We need to look like people who are going to heaven. We need to have that about us, about our character, the kind of people we are. So that a little bit of heaven on earth happens because we're there and we're going to heaven. Another message in this beautiful text is that when Stephen is given this vision, he's given a vision of Jesus. I love that. That vision could have been, who knows, all sort of range of things that he might have seen. But what he sees is the glorified Jesus Christ. I wonder if he looked like what John, 60 years later, saw in his vision in Revelation. Revelation 1. But he saw Jesus in all of his glory. At this church, I know I can say this, I've known many of your pastors. Not all of them, that would be impossible. It goes back too far. But I've known pastors in my own lifetime that have served this church, and I know I can say each one of them put Jesus at the center of his ministry. And that when there were sermons from this pulpit or down there, wherever they preached from, at that point, you knew that that sermon was somehow going to be about Jesus. As many of you know, in 2017, we're going to be celebrating the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation. 500 years since Luther posted those 95 theses. And you know, our synod could have chosen all kinds of themes for that celebration. And my concern was, is this going to be a celebration of Martin Luther, or is it going to be a celebration of Jesus Christ? You know what theme they chose? This is the theme. It's still all about Jesus. That's a good theme. That's one we can get behind. And that's really what this church has been about. It's all about Jesus. A man who once visited a church that I was serving came up to me after the service and said, "My goodness, you sure do use the J word a lot." And he meant the word Jesus. He had come from another Christian church where he simply wasn't hearing the message about Jesus, his perfect life, cross, and resurrection. And it was sort of new for him. Well, it's not new here. It's always been here. Jesus at the center of your life together. Jesus at the center of every baptism. Jesus at the center of every community. That's what this church has been about. It's like Stephen looking into heaven and seeing Jesus. There's a wonderful irony here. The name Stephen, as some of you know, comes from the Greek Stephanos. It refers to that laurel wreath that was placed on the head of an athlete who won in competitions in the ancient games. I remember when the Olympics, not too long ago, were in Greece, they actually put the Stephanos on the head of those who won the gold. And so what an irony that the one whose name means laurel wreath now is the victor, now is the witness to Jesus, who lays down his life and receives the crown of glory. It's beautiful. Stephen saw Jesus. And did you notice, and it's there in the fresco downstairs, Jesus is standing at the right hand of God. My goodness, there have been some PhD dissertations written on why is Jesus standing at the right hand of God? Because our creeds always say, who sits at the right hand of God the Father? What's he doing standing up? And over the centuries, it's been interesting to read, but two of the best arguments I've heard is Jesus is standing up to welcome Stephen into heaven. I like that one. But also Jesus is standing up to give witness to the faithfulness of Stephen as a faithful witness. Jesus witnessing to Stephen's faithfulness before his Father. This church, like every church, has been called to faithfulness. You've been faithful to the scriptures in your life together. But what I love about St. Stephanus, you've also been faithful to the mission of the Lord Jesus Christ. You get that you're here not just to soak up the word every Sunday and then come back in a week and soak it up again. You get, as we heard in the children's sermon, that this good news is meant to be shared. So there's faithfulness to the scriptures and our confessions, but there's also faithfulness to the mission of Jesus Christ. And that's been such a part of this church's history. And then one final point, I think it might be in some of your minds. When we see heaven open with the eyes of faith, we see not only what Stephen saw, but we see what John could see in his revelations. Off in the future, when those on earth will look to the clouds, and Jesus will return in glory on the clouds with all the saints in light. And that great cloud is a great cloud of witnesses. We remember them today, especially those who lived all or part of their lives here at St. Stephanus and who are now in heaven. Names are coming to your mind right now. Images of parents and grandparents, aunts and uncles, of beloved friends who are now in heaven. If I could just fantasize a bit, and I can't guarantee you this will happen, but when Christ returns again in glory, we are all together. I can just imagine two Christians now in heaven coming toward each other and then recognizing each other. We'll look a little differently in heaven. We'll be perfect physically, glorified. We'll all be tens. So it won't be that easy to recognize each other, but I think we will. I can see two former members of this church recognizing each other and saying, St. Stephanus, St. Paul. That's the legacy of this church. Heaven opened through the saving gospel of Jesus Christ. A legacy that continues now, and praise God, forever. Congratulations, St. Stephanus, on 125 years.